Hello learners, welcome to this tele lesson. The topic selected for today's lesson is energy and trophic levels. Now this is a unit of plant ecology which is taught in second year BSc program of botany. Ecology has been defined as a study of interrelationships between organisms and their environment. Ecosystem is a basic functional unit of ecology. Two important events take place in ecosystem. One is a flow of energy, second is a passage of materials through it. So to tell you all the details of these two important events, we have invited an expert in this field. He is Dr. S.K. Balachander. He is a reader in botany at Loyola Academy degree and PG College, Secunderabad. He has more than 25 years of teaching experience. He is a PhD in ecology from Pondicherry University. He has several projects and papers in international and national conferences in ecology, biodiversity and conservation. So, Dr. Balachander.
Dear students, there are several levels of organization of nature in the biosphere. In the realms of ecology, which is the study of the relationship between organism and organism, as well as organisms in relation to their environment, we can classify them into different levels. The most common levels of matter in ecology exist as organisms, populations, communities, ecosystems, and biosphere. The ecosystem is the basic unit of ecology. The ecosystem is the unit of sustainability too. If you look at the particular diagram, an organism exists as a sort of a deer, a single organism. Later on, the organism rises to the higher level and it exists as populations. Several populations can interact with one another and go to form communities. Communities, when they interact with the biotic as well as the abiotic components in terms of matter and energy issues, constitute an ecosystem. Several ecosystems together constitute the biosphere. The biosphere deals with living and non-living components. Coming to the basic unit of ecosystem, within any ecosystem, we have nutrient and material cycling. There is energy cycling and material cycling, and what drives an ecosystem is the solar energy. The solar energy is a thermonuclear device. The solar energy radiates heat by the process of nuclear fission when hydrogen is converted to helium. When hydrogen is converted to helium, there is the liberation of electromagnetic radiation. Among the electromagnetic radiation, the entire solar energy drives the biosphere on Earth. Look at what happens to the sort of a solar energy. Solar radiation primarily gets reflected when it hits the atmosphere. A part of it is absorbed by the ozone. A part of it as visible light gets converted onto plants, animals and microbes. However, when you take plants by the process of photosynthesis are able to capture solar energy. Thus, light energy is converted to chemical energy by the process of photosynthesis. Photosynthesis is an energy capture, energy stabilizing and energy yielding process in green plants. Green plants are the primary link between the sun as well as the productivity which is present in an ecosystem. If you take any ecosystem, there are several ecosystems on planet Earth. Ecosystems constitute the basic units, and ecosystems can vary in latitude and longitude. A common example of an ecosystem could be a desert ecosystem, a pond ecosystem, a riverine ecosystem, a freshwater ecosystem, a desert ecosystem. Even the earth itself is termed as ecosystem ecology. And in an ecosystem, there are several sort of a material and energy cycles. A look at this particular diagram indicates that from the solar energy, there is energy input in the form of light. The energy input which is in the form of light is taken by the producers, that is the biotic components are made up of the producers. So, plants are the first link and they are termed as the producers. From the producers, they are in turn consumed, taken by the carnivores. The carnivores include the herbivores. So, the herbivores feed on the producers, and later on the producers and the consumers are decomposed and broken down by detritus feeders. The detritus feeders constitute the decomposers as well as the saprophytes. It includes the fungi and the bacteria. So, between the producers, consumers and decomposers, there is movement of both nutrients and energy. The movement of both the nutrients and energy forms the basis for an ecosystem. Understanding the ecosystem as a unit of sustainability is based on the flow of nutrients as well as the flow of energy from the sun. When you take a typical sort of an ecosystem, a typical ecosystem for you take as an illustration, we have a plant. The plant is present at the first trophic level or the first nutrition level, and the plants are primarily termed as producers. Producers on the terrestrial system are the plants, producers in the aquatic system are the algae and the phytoplanktons. The plants in turn are eaten by the primary consumers. The primary consumers or the herbivores could be squirrels. The squirrels and the plants, they in turn are consumed by the secondary consumers. The secondary consumers are the carnivores, and they follow a prey-predator relationship. Thus, a higher eagle or a grass, like you have a grasshopper, the grasshopper eats the sort of a plant. Then later on, after the secondary consumers, you have the third order consumers, which are the hawk. The hawk feeds on the smaller prey. The smaller prey, like the grasshopper, eats the sort of a grass, and thereby what happens is a feeding relationship exists between the producers, consumers and the decomposers. Now, a look at what happens at the bottom of the soils. At the bottom of the soils or at the places where wood gets decayed, there is a detritus cycle. A detritus cycle is one which leads to decomposition. On a decay wood, what happens is you could be having soil fungi. You could be having soil fungi and bacteria which can break down the dead organic matter of plants and animals. In addition to this, there could also be protozoans, there could be mites, as well as there could be other sort of an organisms. So, we have primary detritus feeders as well as secondary detritus feeders. The primary detritus feeders are the earthworms, the fungi and the bacteria which together constitute the decomposers. Whereas, when you take the secondary detritus feeders, they include the millipedes and the protozoans. So, whenever we study any ecosystem, there is a sort of a trophic level. Trophic refers to nutrition level or how nutrition passes on from one organism to another organism. The detritus food chain is a very important component of any particular ecosystem. Now, coming to ecosystem per se, if you take a freshwater ecosystem, a freshwater ecosystem is depicted in the form of a diagram. The solar energy is the driving force for the ecosystem. The producers are the rooted plants as well as the algae which are present both in the shallow waters as well as the deep waters. The producers which are present in the water are termed as phytoplanktons. Phytoplanktons in turn are taken by the primary consumers. The primary consumers are the zooplanktons. The zooplanktons in turn are taken by the secondary consumers. The secondary consumers are the fish. So, here what happens is we have from the secondary consumers, again they are taken by the turtles which are the tertiary consumers. So, in an aquatic ecosystem, we have right from the algae to the fish to the larger fish to the carnivore, there is an energy relationship as well as a nutrient relationship. Thus, energy and nutrients keep on flowing within an ecosystem. Same is the case with relation to a sort of a terrestrial ecosystem. In a terrestrial ecosystem, the solar energy drives the ecosystem. We have the producer, the green plants, then including the grasses. The producers are consumed by the primary consumer, which is a rabbit. The primary consumer, which is a rabbit, is again taken by a secondary consumer, which is a fox. So, between the producer, consumer and that sort of a decomposers, the decomposers in turn feed on the plant debris as well as animal debris. There is both energy as well as nutrient flow. Thus, we understand that in an ecosystem, several components of the ecosystem, the biotic components, the producers, consumers and the decomposers, as well as the abiotic components, that is the soil, the water and the air, are interrelated. And in order that an ecosystem need to sustain, or not that it need to keep on going for a very long time, there should be both energy flow as well as nutrient flow. Now, coming to how living organisms are ecologically categorized according to their feeding habits, this is a study in ecology which is termed as trophic levels. Trophic refers to how nutrients are taken up between the producers and the consumers and the decomposers. So, we have a sort of a diagram which says that we have the autotrophs. The autotrophs make their own organic food materials from the inorganic environment. For the autotrophs, we have the photosynthetic green plants as well as the photosynthetic bacteria which are present in the soils, as well as we also have the chemosynthetic bacteria which are present in the soils. So, all of them have got chlorophyll molecules and their primary objective is to capture the solar energy. Then we have the heterotrophs. The heterotrophs need to feed on the organic matter for their sort of an energy. So, the heterotrophs are dependent, they do not have chlorophyll molecules. So, they feed on the sort of a producers. The heterotrophs can be categorized into consumers as well as detritus feeders. If you take the consumers, the primary consumers are the herbivores, that is the animals which feed on the plants. Then we have the omnivores, the animals which feed both on the sort of a plants as well as the animals. Then secondly, we have the secondary consumers. The secondary consumers are the carnivores, the animals which feed on the primary consumers. Then we have even higher order of consumers like the hawk, the animals which feed on other carnivores. Then in addition to this, in the consumers, we have the parasites. The parasites feed on both the plant as well as the animal plant debris. Then in addition to the producers and the consumers under the heterotrophs, we have the detritus feeders. The detritus feeders and the decomposers, they can feed on the plant and animal remains and lead to rotting. Now, what really happens in an ecosystem if we do not have the detritivores, if we do not have the decomposers, the world will be a place full of litter. Nothing would be with relation to breakdown of the sort of a composition of the litter. There could not be any sort of a recycling. Thereby, detritus feeders as well as even grazing feeders are two important components of the ecosystem which keeps on running the sort of an ecosystem. Now, coming back to detritus feeders as well as decomposers. If you look at this particular diagram, we have a block of wood, and on the block of wood, we could be having beetles, we could be having carpenter ants, we could be also having termites, as well as even dry rot fungus. All of these feed on the sort of a wood. So, they are wood decay organisms and they are also termed as detritus feeders. These in turn are fed by means of bacteria as well as fungi and other sort of a microorganisms, and this process is termed as decomposers. Thus, we find very importantly in any particular sort of an ecosystem, we have the solar energy, we have the producers, then we have the consumers, then later on we have the decomposers, and between the ecosystem what happens is there is abiotic cycling of the chemicals. There is carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen and several sort of materials go in. Thus, we find that in an ecosystem, however, whenever there is transfer of energy, when energy moves in from one group like the producers to the consumers, always there is liberation of heat. It follows the first and second law of thermodynamics. According to the first law of thermodynamics, energy can neither be created nor destroyed. According to the second law of thermodynamics, it says that whenever energy moves from one trophic levels or nutritive level to another trophic level, there is always dissipative of energy, that is energy gets broken down or energy is lost. So, how does energy get lost? Energy gets lost by the body building up. Supposing you have a sort of a grasshopper feeding on grass, most of the energy which is derived, that is solar energy, is converted to chemical energy. Chemical energy is available in the form of ATP molecules. When a grasshopper feeds on a grass, the grasshopper takes the ATP for building its own body tissues. It respires, it is used for its own sort of a metabolism. Part of it is also liberated in the form of heat. Part of it is also useful for the breakdown of the grasshopper's body metabolism. And later on what happens is, part of the energy moves from one trophic level to another trophic level, that is from a higher trophic level and to a lower trophic level. Thereby, according to the second law of thermodynamics, always energy is dissipated or energy keeps on breaking down on a sort of a trophic chain. Now, this is a very important sort of a component to realize. Now, coming to a sort of a food chain, whenever we have producers, consumers and decomposers, they are all linked by means of a food chain. The typical diagram of a food chain says that when you take an ecosystem, ecosystems are highly complex. In an ecosystem, from the solar energy, we have the plants which are the primary producers. From the primary producers, we have the primary consumers which are the herbivores. From the herbivores, we have the secondary consumers which are the carnivores. From the carnivores, we have the tertiary consumers which are the top carnivores. Thus, we find that in any particular ecosystem, we have the first trophic level, the first nutrient level, which is the first capture of the sort of a solar energy. Then we have the second trophic level, then we have the third trophic level, and so on and so forth. Thereby, whenever there is a breakdown, whenever there is a fall off, or whenever the organisms decay and die, producers, consumers and decomposers, all of them are decayed by means of detritivores. The detritivores include the decomposers as well as the detritus feeders. But in each succession, between a grass, between a caterpillar, between a bird and a sort of a hawk, whenever there is a movement of transfer of energy, always heat is lost. So, thus what happens is always heat energy is lost, and this is primarily termed as a sort of a method, this is a model of a food chain. So, when you take a food chain, in addition to the food chain, when you take any particular ecosystem, this diagram is the best example of an ecosystem. If you take, we understand here that we have plants. Plants have got seeds. Seeds are taken by means of squirrels, and the squirrels in turn are eaten by the fox. So, this constitutes a sort of a food chain. A food chain is a link between a producer, a consumer, both of the consumers, and whereas what happens is, when you take a food web, a food web is made up of an interrelated component of different sort of a food chains. Like if the food is taken by both the squirrel as well as by the rabbit, and the squirrel and the rabbit are in turn consumed by the cows as well as they are also consumed by human beings. This complex of arrows constitutes a sort of a food web. So, we understand that a food web is a very complex interrelationship which occurs within an ecosystem. It is in turn made up of food chains. And again, when you take an ecosystem which is made up of food chains and food webs, we can arrange them on the basis of the nutrient levels. The first trophic level includes all the producers. The second trophic level includes all the herbivores. The third trophic levels include all the primary carnivores. Thus, we understand that an ecosystem is a basic integrated unit. This diagram indicates how from solar energy, when you take solar energy in any particular trophic level, we have the solar energy. The solar energy is converted to chemical energy, that is via photosynthesis. Whenever this sort of transfer occurs, there is wasting of heat. Similarly, from chemical energy, it is taken into the sort of a food which we eat. The chemical energy is converted into food. So, from photosynthesis to food, again there is loss of energy, heat loss. From food, we do mechanical energy. The energy which we take, we have got to do for our daily work, like moving, thinking and living. Even when we do these particular activities, heat is lost. Thus, we find that according to the second law of thermodynamics, whenever we take any particular living system within an ecosystem, there is always dissipation of energy. Now, coming to energy flow within a food chain. When we have the sort of a food chain, the food chain is made up of producers, it is made up of consumers as well as decomposers. And when you take the food chain can be diagrammatically represented. The transfer of energy in a food chain depends upon the metabolic efficiency of the organisms which are involved. If you take the algae are highly productive. If you take a plant which is present in a tropical rainforest, it is highly productive and highly efficient. So, plants are metabolically more efficient. That is one of the reasons why we should always try to follow that we need to have a vegetarian diet. A vegetarian diet is healthy because it gives you more of energy at the first level, at the first trophic level. However, when you take the society, in today's society, we seem to be consuming all type of food materials. The type of the food material which we consume, like if you take green vegetables lock in more of photosynthetic efficiency and more of energy, thereby consuming more, being a sort of a person with more vegetable diet is always advantageous. So, plants are metabolically more efficient. This particular diagram indicates that we have 100% solar energy coming in. Then there is reflected light and heat. This goes into the biomass of the plant. Biomass of the plant is the amount of material which it consumes after photosynthesis. Then from here, 2% of the biomass after the plant uses it for flowering, fruiting, rooting, only 2% of the energy level goes to the next trophic level. Supposing cows feed on plants, they only get 2% of the energy. And again, cows, they need to metabolically, they need to respire and they need to be metabolically active, and then again there is undigested food and again there is lot of debris. So, from the 2% of the efficient energy which the cow gets, then what happens is, if the lions feed on the cow, they only get 7% of the 2%. Thus, we find that on a trophic level in a food chain, there is always loss of energy. So, ultimately what the predator, what the lion gets from the sort of a, by eating the plants is, it gets 1% of 7% of 2%. Thereby, in a trophic level, what happens is, always the energy falls down or the energy gets dissipated. Now, in case the food chain is more complex, if it involves a longer food chain, like if you take plants, plants are eaten by means of beetles, beetles are eaten by means of praying mantis are eaten by higher birds, and higher birds are eaten by means of a hawk. If the food chain, is more longer, then what happens is, it becomes relatively little bit inefficient, because actually the energy which the hawk gets will be less. Thereby, what happens is, we need to understand that if we want to support large number of animals, our trophic levels and our energy consumption patterns in an ecosystem should be very efficient. That is, energy need to be cycled, nutrient to be need to be cycled. However, we understand when we take any particular ecosystem, we understand that sometimes in a food chain, certain compounds can get accumulated. Like you take the simple instance, like I am giving you one example of what are the applications of your knowledge of trophic levels. If DDT percolates in the water, DDT which percolates in the water accumulates in the phytoplanktons. Phytoplanktons are in turn taken by means of the zooplanktons. The zooplanktons in turn are eaten by the fish. The fish in turn are eaten by the birds. The birds in turn hatch the eggs. And in the eggs, what happens is, there is concentration of the sort of a DDT. Thereby, this process is called as biomagnification. Now, a simple reminder, like if you take a food chain, this diagram indicates a food chain is very simple. However, between these three components, what happens is, you could get several other sort of an organisms. When several other organisms come, this is termed as a sort of a food, this is termed as a food web. Thereby, this diagram indicates a food web which occurs in the oceans. Now, parallel to this, sometimes what happens is, we have certain concepts termed as primary productivity. The amount of energy which plants get to capture is termed as productivity. The total amount of energy which a plant captures is termed as gross primary productivity. Supposing the plant loses on respiration, then ultimately what it gets is termed as net primary productivity. So, plants which can be estimated for productivity, they can be estimated on the basis of how many kilocals of energy they take per unit area per unit time, or per dry weight per unit time. Thus, net primary productivity, gross primary productivity and biomass are different components also to indicate about trophic levels. Thus, what we understand is, when you read about trophic levels and energy flows, we understand we should have a good knowledge of the energy flow, trophic levels, then again energy flow, trophic levels, biomagnification, food chains and food webs. And this forms the basic basis for understanding sustainability, because once you save an ecosystem or save a unit of sustainability, we can conserve the basic natural resources. Thus, when we take on with relation to ecosystems, in ecosystems, what happens is, depending upon the biomass of energy, biomass of organisms, we can organize their sort of an energy components on the basis of their biomass. A simple look at this particular diagram indicates that those by weight, if the producers are more by weight, they are indicated by a sort of a rectangle at the bottom. After the producers, we have the primary consumers. Then we have the secondary consumers. We have the tertiary consumers. Thereby, in any particular field, we have the biomass of numbers where the producers are large. Whereas, when you take biomass of numbers in grasslands too, the biomass is very, very large. Whereas, in aquatic ecosystems, it is very much inverted. A simple example is, this indicates that when you take diversity, tropical rainforests and coral reefs are highly diverse in nature, which are also examples of ecosystems. An ecological pyramid is a graphic representation of the different trophic levels of organisms which you see in an ecosystem. An ecological pyramid is a sort of a diagram which indicates the biomass at the first trophic level, which is green. If you look at the diagram, if you take all the grasses, they are represented by a sort of a green stratification at the base. This indicates the producers. Next, we have the biomass of the second trophic level. That is the total combined mass of all the herbivores constitute the second biomass. The total mass of all the carnivores constitutes the third trophic level. Thereby here, whenever we are talking in terms of energy and when you are talking in terms of nutrient, the total accumulation which gets accumulated can be represented by means of an ecological pyramid. And in an ecological pyramid, what is the advantage is we can compare different sort of an ecosystems. We can make comparisons of ecosystems, we can exactly know how the sort of a solar energy is getting trapped, how it is getting distributed. So, knowledge of ecological pyramids is of grave concern. Ecological pyramids could be of biomass based on the total weight or the mass of the organisms, could be with relation to the numbers of the organisms. Like if you take a tropical rainforest, in a tropical rainforest the number of trees are very, very high, thereby the producers are also very, very high. However, if you take one single tree in a forest, a single tree in a tropical rainforest can contain myriads of microorganisms. Thereby, here the microbial biomass could be very, very high. So, these all can be depicted and represented by means of ecological pyramids. Similar is the case even with relation to trophic levels. In trophic levels, the rectangular block which you see at the bottom, which indicates the producers, that is an index of the total amount of kilocalories of solar energy which is caught per unit area, per unit time by all the organisms, and the primary producers forms the basis of the sort of a trophic level. Thus, by each trophic level, when it has been moved from the bottom to the top, an ecological a trophic level is said to be upright, or an ecological pyramid is said to be upright whenever the producers are at the bottom and the decomposers and the tertiary consumers are at the top. So, trophic levels as well as ecological pyramids are good indices to study an ecosystem and also to compare an ecosystem.
You have heard in detail all about energy and trophic levels. Dr. B. S. K. Balachandar, he spoke on different ecosystems like the terrestrial ecosystem, the freshwater ecosystem and the grassland ecosystem. He also dwelt in great details about the food chains, the different trophic levels which exist in a trophic, in a food chain, and also he also spoke about the food web. He also made a reference to bioaccumulation with particular reference to DDT. I hope the lesson was very clear to you. Thank you.